Are you concerned about our city?
Of course, I'm always concerned about our city, and particularly in light of what's going on nationally, as well as what's happening here locally, we are all concerned. We want, particularly on the public safety end, people want to feel safe, and we want to make sure that our police department is operating at its full efficiency and with high morale. So yeah, we're all concerned.
Who is running APD right now? Is it the mayor? Is it the interim chief? Is it city council? Who's in charge? Who's calling the shots?
Well, based on the way our government operates, the executive branch runs the day-to-day operations of the city, headed by the mayor, and the police officers are under the command of, right now, interim chief Bryant. And so they, in conjunction with each other, and I'm sure they collaborate on things, are the ones that are operating the police department.
You've been listening to so many residents talking about defunding the police department, about issues of reform. You've had all kinds of hours to listen. Are we moving too fast on this issue? It's taken generations to get where we are in terms of policing, yet there is this cry now, and it's become very popular, to defund police. But where are we going? Is there an ambiguity here? I mean, we're talking about very big American cities like Atlanta that are violent, that need public safety.
Well, and I think that first of all, the defund the police is one without a definition. And so different people think of it in different ways, but I think all people agree that our policing and how we do it in this country and in our city can be reformed. And some of that may take resources. It may take funding in terms of additional training, more community engagement, that kind of thing. The council has grappled with it. And at this point, the council has not touched the police department's budget at this point. But what they have touched and what they are working on is working on those reform measures and getting them going. It's being done by the executive branch as well as the council.
What do you think it should look like? What do you think policing should look like? And again, there's a certain ambiguity asking that question. Nobody really knows what that means. Is that more social workers? Does that money go directed toward trying to diffuse things without policing? It's very difficult to understand exactly what it means.
Well, again, it means different things to different people, but reform to me looks like first starting to look at the culture of policing. And that's a difficult lift, making some culture changes. I would love to see it look like how we engage citizens, as you look at some videos on how they do it in other countries, some of them unarmed. I'm not suggesting that they all have to be unarmed. But one thing that I noticed in those instances is it took more patience and more time from the police to subdue someone or to get them to comply. And so that is some of the things I would love to see at the one end be the ultimate thing that we do. But in between, I think we've got to come to some agreement. And that is with the public agreeing, it's what is the level of force that we can use? And particularly, what is the level of force that is acceptable to the public when someone does not comply and they resist arrest? And that's usually where you find the force come in. And then what type of force do we want our officers to use? I think that's the first thing.
Well, you talk about force. I mean, it's really a wake-up call when you see all the shootings we had over the 4th of July weekend.
Oh,
and you look at that and you go, well, okay, great. We like the idea of social workers. We like less force. But then you see that violence and you go, whoa, wait a minute. You can't necessarily have it both ways, or can you?
Well, I don't think that, I think there's got to be a middle ground. And again, that's saying what is socially acceptable? What can people accept? And what do people do? Because, you know, I was up to 4 a.m. on the 4th and people were shooting me videos and texts. And yeah, the things that I was seeing were assaults upon people as well as police officers. And so we've got to figure out a way, because, you know, I know one video I saw in Zone 3 where people were shooting fireworks at police officers and they're standing there taking it and brushing off embers from fireworks. And then I saw a light and they were shooting lasers in their eyes. You can permanently damage someone's eyes or blind them. And so, you know, that's not acceptable to me on the other end of that. These are, take off their uniforms, they're human beings. People shouldn't be assaulted. So we've got to agree on our rules of engagement, how we engage each other, how we engage the police, and what happens when a police has someone who is resisting arrest, what level of force will the public accept?
You've been talking about morale of police. You've been talking about APD. Paul Howard is immersed in a runoff August 11th. Does he need to go, in your estimation?
Well, I don't want to get into, because he's running for office, a political speech about that. But I will say that our morale of our police officers, people are saying it's low. When I'm talking to officers on all levels, there's no morale. And it starts with some actions that were taken at the city and have been exacerbated by actions that are taken by the DA. And I think that he's saying he's not doing it for political reasons, but whatever reasons he's doing it, it is not helping with the morale of our police officers. They are not engaging people because they're fearful they're either, one, going to be fired from the city, or two, be charged by the DA. So that is a part of it. If you are an officer, you've got a family to feed and you're trying to just make it, you're fearful of having those interactions with the public that may come to a part of having to subdue someone, because you're not sure that if you do that, if those, you're going to be charged.
You know, when you look at the history of Atlanta, you always see a sort of symbiotic relationship between the mayor, the governor, and business. Now you're seeing a deep division between Mayor Bottoms, Governor Kemp, and as far as Atlanta business goes, you know, the days of Robert Woodruff and Don Keough and Ivester and all of these people that we knew so well at Coca-Cola, I'm going to guess the majority of people couldn't even name who leads Coca-Cola these days. I don't even know if he lives here. The role of business has changed. Would you agree with that? And is that a great concern for us in Atlanta as we go forward?
Well, I'm not sure that the role of business has changed. I know that, you know, those leaders always find a way to have access to those in power and to reach out and to share their concerns. And in terms of the role between the mayor and the governor, you know, we've enjoyed great relationships, the city with the governor's office, and we've had times like now when it's contentions. I believe that the mayor is doing it in the vein that she believes that this COVID-19 pandemic is serious and people are hurting, and that she wants stronger measures. And so they're just sort of fighting that out.
Is Atlanta in big trouble as it relates to the pandemic because of falling tax revenues? And I guess part of the question is, how far have revenues fallen, and how do we keep services going on in Atlanta if the money is not there?
And that's a good question. I just was on another call and I made this statement to people that I strongly believe in. I'm one that's been a fiscal watchdog for a city government for a long time, that we're going to have to go back and revisit our budget at some point, unless things get better, and they're predicting that they're not getting better. There was just an article that's come out that talked about our bond ratings being reduced for Atlanta Fulton County Recreation Authority, which did bonds for the State Farm Arena. The reduction in the bond rating for the Mercedes-Benz Stadium, which is held up by hotel motel taxes. All of these things are things that every city, but in particular Atlanta, is going to have to grapple with, because the budget that the council just passed did not really take that into account. And eventually we're going to have to deal with it.
When I think about the history of this city, I always think about council presidents and mayors duking it out a little bit, mixing it up. Is your relationship with Mayor Bottoms healthy? And is it in the vein with the tradition of this city that that's how business is done on these fronts?
Well, you know, I'm not one to start fights, but I don't run from them either. You know, I would love to have a more communicative relationship with the mayor, but at this point we are doing our jobs in our own respective things. I'm head of the legislative branch and she's running the city.
If she becomes VP or she joins a new administration, mm-hmm. would you like to be mayor?
Well, it's not a matter of what I'd like to be. When I signed up to be council president, I understood that I would be in succession to be the mayor if anything happened with the mayor. So it would not be something that I had to choose to do that would be part of my job.
You remain optimistic about the future of the city despite the current troubles?
Of course, because they all can be addressed. And it's just a matter of us facing up to those and addressing them. And I am hopeful that the council will do its part, as well as the mayor and the executive branch, working together on behalf of the citizens of Atlanta.
President Moore, thanks for your time. I really appreciate it.